Good morning, fantasy football fans, and welcome to another episode of the Brady Fantasy Football Podcast, where if you are listening, your family. Week four is over and done. Do we have a show for you today. Jace's reign of terror is over. Aaron flips the script on everyone, and McCaffrey shows us why he's still king. Let's take a look at the standings. Coogdit claims the number one spot after week four in his victory against Jace. He moves to 3-1, while Jace also moves to 3-1. Scott is on a three-game win streak, and Jace just got his 18-game streak ended, taking the second spot. After Jace, we have myself bumping all the way up to third somehow. Jake, who I faced this week, behind me at 505 points, which is pretty gnarly. 2-2. Travis, Aaron, Steve, Corey, and then coming up on the rear of the caboose there is Amy and Brian at the bottom, both 1-3. So we got the leaders here. They're not too far ahead, but they're definitely, you know, ahead here. And then we got all the monkeys and chickens. Well, not quite chickens, but fighting here in the the middle part here, in the mid part of the standings, and then we got 1-3, 1-3. Yeah, it's still early in the season. We've seen a few highs and a few lows just the first 4 weeks. Some of the biggest news this week is that the Houston Texans look actually pretty damn good. I picked up C.J. Stroud, so I'm a little biased, but C.J. Stroud looked like the dude, and he won the hearts of Texans everywhere with a killer post-game speech, which I'll play for you, just a snippet of it for you now.
I want to say, man, and I've been thinking about this for a long time. Y'all deserve to feel special. Y'all deserve to root the Texans on. Like, not winning since 2021, I think it was around Christmas. Like that ain't flying from like anybody in this building. I want them to know, like, we're frying our tails off every day to make sure y'all walk around with Texan gear pride.
The Broncos are garbage, but the Chicago Bears are even more garbage. So there are fantasy points to be had in this garbage fest, but I mean, like we saw on Thursday Night Football, there are definitely fantasy points to be had if your name is DJ Moore and you didn't leave him on the bench like Jace. Alvin Kamara's back and looking good. Devon Achane is looking like fantasy gold, sitting there on Jake's bench again. And Cooper Kupp is off IR, which I know Steve will be happy about. So what does that mean for my Puka Nacua? We'll see. And with all that, we'll jump into the matchups of the week. The very first one we're going to take a look at today is myself versus Amy. So, I mean, don't want to be, because of the caps, it looks like we're kind of screaming at each other, which I thought was kind of funny. Do your job against all odds. Do your job against all odds. But feels good. Feels good. Ooh, baby, feels good. 165 to Amy's 107. Sorry to send you back to the bottom there, Amy, but it sure as hell ain't gonna be me. If you're looking for a masterclass on how to read your team this week, then pull up a chair and you can walk you through a little bit how the magic happened here, because I hit Amy with that wombo combo. Happy feet. Wombo combo. That ain't Falco. Oh, 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 oh. Of Stephon Diggs and Puka Nacua for 39 and 34 points. I mean, looking at my team for this last week, had to put the Patriots jersey down and look at that Dallas defense and say, it's not happening. I cannot in good faith start Ramondre, Mac Jones, or Kendrick Bourne. So I had to bench those boys, and I'm glad I did, because they didn't do very great there. My other choices definitely did much better. So happy about that. Jerome Ford didn't do quite as good as hoping against the Baltimore Ravens there, but that's okay, because a lot of other people did their jobs with Stephon Diggs and Puka Nacua leading the way big time. I scooped up C.J. Stroud, which I already mentioned. He looks like a pro in his rookie year. Pretty good pick if you ask me. We'll see what happens. I might even bump up the Texans a little bit into the upper echelon of teams I like with how he's handled himself thus far. I mean, he's definitely put on a show. I'm over on Amy's end. She left 43 points on the bench, which is, you know, for in the first round pick, Bijan Robinson on the bench. Interesting. Marquise Brown, 16. Christian Kirk, 16. And Lamar Jackson is kind of the big oof there, 29 points to Daniel Jones's 7 points in that huge loss, throwing two interceptions and a fumble. The Seattle Seahawks there, 3-24. That's a rough one. I'd hate to have been in her position. the bright spots, however, were Justin Jefferson, 26 points, doing his job, holding it down, 85 reception yards and receiving yards, and two receiving touchdowns. Also had Alvin Kamara on his return, 51 yards rushing, 33 receiving yards for 21.4 points total. He didn't get a touchdown, but that's okay. He didn't need it. He's picking up the yards. He was also... I mean, the kicker, I guess the other bright spot, I mean, like I mentioned, DeAndre Swift. DeAndre Swift looks like the, you know, the bona fide number one running back there for Philly. So that's a solid pickup that she had, and he seems to be doing okay. Okay there. T. Higgins is looking like, I know he was out for that game on only 19 reception yards, receiving yards there. I mean, that's a rough one. I mean, he had two other wide receivers would have been nice. Still got hold on to two kickers with Justin Tucker, and even though he's got Tyler Bass there. Steelers D letting them down a little bit, letting her down a little bit, 3 points. I mean, I had the Browns, who only got me 4.9, so not like I have any room to talk there, but the Steelers defense versus Houston, oof. Sorry, Travy. Anyways, that's that for this one. We're going to jump ahead to hit the matchup last week, Scott versus Jace. And ooh-wee, what a matchup we got this week. I said it was the matchup of the week, but once Scott got going, he never let up on the gas. You can see right here, starts early, Kyren Williams, and then it doesn't get any better for Jace the whole week there. Pretty rough for him. Scott started Josh Allen, who put up almost 40 against Miami. Also from Kyren Williams with 27 points against the Colts. Scott bet against his own running back by playing the Colts defense as well there. He also had the Colts running back, Zach Moss. So 4.52 points there on the defense. And the Seahawks D, he left on the bench, who went crazy, 34.12 against the New York Giants, the most on the week. Despite the regret Scott might feel about benching the Seahawks defense, I don't think anybody has more regret this week than Jace, who went ahead and benched Nico Collins versus Pittsburgh, who went off 168 receiving yards and two receiving touchdowns. He's the number two receiver on the week, hauling in 40.8 points against Travis's Pittsburgh Steelers. He left a total of 51 points on the bench, which is the highest on the week. Ooh. Jace was projected going into this one. Projected to win by the widest margin of 31.9 points. But not only did he lose to Scott, he lost by a bigger margin than he was projected to win by, which was 41. So unfortunate there. Well played, Scott. I said it last week, and I'll say it again, but if there's anyone who could have put a stop to Chase's 18-game win streak that started in week three of last season, it was going to be Scott, and his team cooged it. He's dead. You can't believe. You know now. Not going to be another crazy year, hopefully, of him just dominating from week three on. But you're a hero, Scott. Thank you. I'm sure this isn't the last we've heard, however, from the Jace. Okay, our next matchup is going to be, we're going to jump back here one more to a Steve versus Travis. Steve and his Silver Spartans versus Kenny's Tiny Well, Travis probably needs to rename his team at this point because Kenny's Tiny Hands have nothing to do with this team at all. The story for Travis's team this week is the story of one handsome young man grabbing a backpack, sticking eight other players inside of it, and then rushing and catching for a total of 4 touchdowns for almost 200 yards and 50 fantasy points, Christian McCaffrey. This victory by Travis moved both teams to 2-2. And moving forward, if CMC can keep it up and Travis can tighten up some stuff here and there, he could be in trouble. We're on the other side of the ball. Steve and his Silver Spartans are just getting started. He might have dumped his first round pick after week one in Bijan Robinson, but Steve is about to get his third round pick back, Cooper Kupp, as he has been officially removed from IR and is ready to catch some balls. With that said, well played, Mr. Trolltoes, this week, and best of luck to you both in your next matchups in week 5. The next matchup we'll be looking at is going to be Curb Your Enthusiasm versus Team 9. In the closest matchup of the week, we had a game that had a little back and forth on Thursday night, but once the Sunday games got started here, it was see you later. Jake jumped ahead, and Corey tried his best throughout the rest of the weekend there, Sunday night and Monday, and couldn't do nothing, unfortunately. The standout players for Jake was the Yeti and Derrick Henry, King Henry there at 25 points versus Cincinnati. And Terry McLaurin at 24 points versus Philadelphia. Keenan Allen helping a little bit. Devontae Smith helping a little bit. But those are the kind of the big ones. The other side of the ball, the only kind of really bright spot there is also the brightest in Jake's heart. That would be Justin Herbert, 23 points versus Las Vegas. He also hurt his thumb during it, but sounds like it's his non-throwing hand. And he mentioned in this post-interview or whatever, I don't know if it's the next day or... after the game or what, but he was quoting Monty Python, 'tis but a flesh wound.
Justin, congrats on the win. How does the hand feel, and can you run through what happened on the play that got hurt?
Okay, thank you. 'Tis but a scratch, just a flesh wound, and just got stuck in a helmet, but thankful for all the doctors and all the trainers out there to, you know, help me get through that.
So that was pretty funny. He's not worried about it, so we're not worried about it. He threw for 167 pass yards and one touchdown. He also threw an interception, but we don't got to mention that necessarily. We got to dwell on that too much. He did a lot better than Corey's other option, which was Kirk Cousins, who only got 10.5 points, so he made the right start there. Corey gave it all. It was all this week. It was he only left 6 points on the bench, which was about the third best in the league in terms of leaving points on the bench. He was very effective in his coaching this week. I think that mainly comes from him not starting the... Looks like the Bills, 1272 to the Chiefs, 6.4 is kind of the big one there. So he did great. I mean, he gave it his all. It just wasn't enough, really. In this side of the ball, Jake's just kind of getting started. He beat him, what he's sitting on, Anthony Richardson's 30-point game in his loss to L.A. and Devon Achane's 28-point game versus Buffalo. Both of them losses, but both putting up big points. He's also, I mean, Barkley's, I don't know when he's getting back. He'll be back later this year from what I understand. And then Austin Eckler is expected to be back probably after the bye. So he'll be out week 5, and then hopefully week 6 he's back. So he's got some guys coming in hot next week, and we'll see what happens there. But I don't know how you, I got a bone to pick with Jacob out here, Jake a little bit though. How do you pick up, so you end 10th, you're at the bottom of the standings last week. You got the number one waiver wired pick, right? And you grabbed the man who went bananas, 50 points the week prior. You pick him up, and then you say, you know what? Let's sit him on the bench. I have Joshua Kelly, who I can play instead, who has not been doing anything, really. I mean, 15 week one, but 3, 2, and 6. I mean, he's not doing much. And so you look at that and say, you know what? We'll plug Joshua Kelly in again. And leave Devon Achane on the bench. I just don't understand that. I mean, come on, man. How you gonna disrespect him like that, my man? How do you not have the faith that he's gonna? Even, I know it's against Buffalo. I know they lost, but he got 2 of the rushing touchdowns of their 20 points. He got 12 of their 20 points. I mean, that's crazy. Anyways, I just don't know how you're gonna do it, man. I mean, with that, we'll touch a little bit more on Corey. Corey had some rough luck. Jamar Chase did a serviceable job with 14.3. I mean, he didn't do a great job, not a first-round draft pick kind of thing.
In 4 games this season, do you feel like you've had less time to get open and create space for yourself?
Nah, I'm open. I'm always open. Excuse my profanity. I'm sorry.
And then Garrett Wilson wheeling in 15 in his loss. Again, not fantastic. And with Chubb out on IR, probably not coming back this year. And the Lions using David Montgomery instead of Jamar Gibbs. So Jamar Gibbs was held to 9 points versus David Montgomery. We'll touch in a second. Went crazy. It's hard to see how he's going to turn this around. You know, Jake has some extra stuff in the tank there. You can see, Corey, I mean, Jake's not. I mean, he had Aaron Rodgers go down, but he didn't spend the same draft capital that Chubb is. Chubb's a second round draft pick. Aaron Rodgers was grabbed like in the 7th or 8th round, like as a late round QB pick kind of grab. You know what I mean? And even with Derrick Henry, I mean, he's got Devon Achane and Barkley and Eckler. Like, he's got options if he wanted to replace Joshua Kelly. You know what I mean? Next week or maybe week 6. But Corey. I mean, Corey's got the number 24 running back, Miles Sanders, to replace Chubb, and the number 54 running back, Dalvin Cook, to replace him. This is just not the same level. You know what I mean? It's unfortunate there, and I hope Corey will probably be on the waivers here soon, or maybe looking to make a trade, because I don't know how it's gonna go. I think next week. Did I play Jake next week? Yeah, I do play. I'm playing Jake right now. So I play Jake next week. I think I misspoke earlier when I said Amy does. I play him next week. So good luck, Corey, next week. Sorry, Jake. I hope I crush you painfully. I hope you just do terrible. And that's after this matchup of the week. This moves us into our last matchup of the week. The highest scorer of the week. The biggest blowout of the week. Liberty Bibbity versus the vicious tiger-headed club. Don't get it twisted. This rap shit is mine, motherfuckers. Aaron heard us talking shit to him last week on the podcast and went ahead and flipped the entire script. Maybe this will be the theme of the year, because we've already seen Amy do this. She had the least points to the most points. Brian, least points to the most points. Aaron, least points to the most points. And now if this week, Majace gets the most points, which she might have been able to do with UJ Moore, then it's definitely like we got a pattern going on here, right? 4 weeks in a row is not a joke. That's not an accident. That's something's going on here. Something fishy's going on here. We'll see what happens. Maybe it'll take someone to hit that low to bring the energy back next week. Maybe that's what it takes. I don't know. I haven't been in the position yet. But what I do know is that Aaron's team went off this week. AJ Brown, showing why he's a early number, you know, early draft pick there. AJ Brown, highest on the week, 41.5 points for a wide receiver. Going crazy, showing why he's a number round 2 draft pick there. Dallas defense going crazy, 28.5, the second highest on the week. And we're going to scooch you right up here to a David Montgomery. Coming in with 35.1 points. The second highest on the week. Behind Christian McCaffrey, who got almost 50. And everyone else was holding their own. I mean, the weakest link on his team this week was the kicker, Jason Sanders, who just came back from a crazy scoring 10 PATs last week to making just 2 this week. No field goals, just 2 point after attempts. That's it. And Aaron also went ahead and went perfect this week, left 0. He ate it all up and left no crumbs, leaving 0 points on the bench, which is just great. I mean, you love to see it. Unless you're Brian, of course. Unless you're the vicious tiger-headed cluck, then maybe not. And it's unfortunate, really, that it happened to Brian, because Brian is, he's not doing bad by any means. He had 117 points, which is the 5th highest on the week, I believe. So he would have beat the other half of the league if he was up against anyone else, really. Or actually, looks like maybe he's the 4th. Yeah, maybe the 4th highest, if I'm looking at that right. So he would have beat 6 other people this week if he had played 6 any of the other people, or 5 of the other people there, if he would have beat them. So it's unfortunate. He had a great week. His team didn't do bad. He threw in the rookie Jordan Love. I mean, if we look at the points for the league now, which I'll pull up real quick just so you can see. It's already on the screen, I guess, but we sorted it for the points for. I mean, Liberty Bibby's at 527 after this crazy week, and Brian's right behind him at 523. The difference is this number right here. So Aaron has scored the second highest points on the week this year. And Amy scored the most points in our league since on week 2, which was the highest since like the year 2020. So these are both like huge weeks. Both of them were against Brian. So Brian is just a little bit unlucky there in having to have faced both Amy on her super week and now Aaron on the super week. And I mean, if we're looking at this points for right now, I mean, you see Amy's at 510, and there's a huge, I mean, in terms of the points against here, if we do this, Brian has the most against, and Scott has 200. I mean, 198, so I'm rounding up a bit, but 200 more points than Scott. So yeah, definitely a contributing factor to his record there. Brian should not feel bad about it. I mean, normally he's led to victory by his two wide receivers, who both had a pretty quiet week. Davante Adams at 15, Tyreek Hill at 10. Mandrews helped, was pulling his way, doing his best to help, 25 points. Isaiah Pacheco having a great week. I think this is best on the year so far, 26.8. Yeah, best on his, yes, best so far. Jordan Love was thrown in over Joe Burrow, which was a great choice there. 16 to what is that, 4? So definitely the better choice there for Jordan Love to be in there. And I mean, looking at these two teams, I got no doubt both these guys are playoff contenders. Both these guys got good rosters. They're making moves. I see him on the waivers. I see Brian changing his name to the vicious tiger-headed cluck. We'll see what he changes it to next week. If he keeps changing it or not, I don't know. I'll keep checking below before I record this stuff because I think it's hilarious. And yeah, I mean, that's all I got to say about this one. I can't wait to see how these teams continue to do. Liberty Bibbity faces off against Team 9 next week, and the vicious tiger-headed cluck will go head-to-head against the Silver Spartans to see if he can keep climbing. Best of luck to you, too. Thank you. Our next thing we're going to look at is the Thursday night football recap. Pretty easy one. I made the bad bet of starting the Washington Commanders against Chicago because I figured, hey, it's Chicago. Should be easy. 10 points or so, somewhere in there. I was wrong. 0.8 points. Super unfortunate. They decided to go off. If they didn't get 3 sacks, I would have been negative again, which is unfortunate. It is what it is. You gotta roll with it. Sometimes you're going to make a bet like that. It's not going to pay off. It is what it is, you know. Besides that, Jake got 8.9 from Terry McLaurin. I can deal with that. I'm hoping Zay can outperform that, you know, take Jake down. I got to keep climbing up this leaderboards here. This next one, we got Travis 7.6 from Khalil Herbert, who got injured at some point. So I don't know what the status is on that. And then Steve with Brian Robinson, 8.3. He dropped Bijan Robinson and picked up Brian Robinson and got 8.3 points out of him. And then if we head back to this one, I mean, this is the real, ooh, we talked about it in the group chat already, but oh, man. Oh, this is a rough one. It's rough to see, you know what I mean? 53 points up on the bench, DJ Moore. 230 receiving yards, 3 receiving touchdowns. He's really the biggest loser of Thursday night. Not the Washington Commanders, but Jace of Team Mahase. I mean, that's the biggest L right there. 53 points on the bench. I'm sure he's not alone in it. I'm sure millions of fantasy league mates are going through the same thing here, being like, oh my god, how am I supposed to know DJ Moore was going to go crazy? You didn't. That's fantasy football, but ouch. Ouchy boo boo. 53 smackaroonies down the drain. Lucky for Travis, he was benched. And, I mean, it's not over yet. There's still plenty of football to be had. There's only one person who's played. We got the whole weekend to go. And Jace is still projected to kick his butt, so it might not even matter. But, I mean, it's you hate to see it. The other thing about this is he left 53 on the bench. He did this last week where he left someone on the bench. I forget who it was. Nico Collins got 40 points on the bench. So, I mean, hey, it happens. It happens to Jace more than others, but it happens, you know. Jonathan Taylor apparently is practicing in with the Indianapolis Colts. So he's got some more fuel in the tank there. I see he's sitting on the Eagles D and the Lions D, so he's playing his cards there versus Carolina. We'll see how that goes. But anyways, just wanted to touch on that. Besides that, I mean, not very many Commanders or Bears players were started. I mean, and the only one that was really kind of noteworthy here wasn't that started. Justin Fields was also, he might have actually been, take a look here. He might have been, no one's got him. Yeah, he's a free agent right now, so someone could pick him up if they want. He's getting 28 points and 34 points the last 2 weeks. He's up against Minnesota last week, which has a terrible defense, so he might keep going. We'll see. It'd be nice for the Bears because they ain't got much, you know. So if they could get a couple dubs, it'd be nice for them. We will touch on and close this episode out, because that's the end of the Thursday night recap. Take a look at the coach rating again here. So this is through week 4, where how many points left on the bench. So Jace 51, Amy 43, Herb 39, Coog at 36, And then we got 18, 14, 13, 6. Me only leaving 130, trying to turn the ship around, baby, you know, on the bench. And then Liberty Bibbity with the perfect week. Again, my hats off. My hats off to you, good sir. Because that is just, that's great. Great to see. You love to see it when someone can put all those pieces together and get a dub, you know. Beyond that, we also have the true rating, which I was like taking a dig at, even though I hate seeing where I'm at in it. Basically puts together your record, the points for the breakdown, which is interesting. The breakdown is how many people you'd beat. So this is, again, Brian. Just shows how unlucky he is. I mean, he would have, out of the 36 possible people he could have played over the first 4 weeks, he would have beaten 25 of them, which is more than anybody else. Then you see, like, me and Corey down here. Ouch, you know. Whereas Travis is hitting that 50-50. Liberty Bibbity's above it. Kugdit's above it. Mahase and Jake are sitting there at 21 and 15, so above it. Yeah, so I just like showing that off. I think it's interesting. Because this true rating just breaks down these three and puts it in one. So you can see he's kind of doing the best overall. And so what's interesting is this is the record is the big thing killing him here. Because of his unlucky matchups, he's just not doing as well. But anyway, I won't go on this anymore. I'll call this episode. Thank you very much for tuning in. Thanks very much for sticking around if you made it to this point. I appreciate it. I love putting these together. And best of luck to everyone except for Jake next week. And I will see you all next week. Adios.